Warning: boiling sulfuric acid is extremely corrosive. Wear protective clothing when handling it. Toxic fumes can also be produced. Perform this procedure outside on a fume hood. Greetings, fellow nerds. I need purified lab-grade sulfuric acid again as I'm planning to do experiments in electroplating and analytical chemistry. While using drain cleaner sulfuric acid is good enough for a lot of purposes, I need something better. So I'm going to revisit one of the more dangerous amateur chemistry procedures and distill my drain cleaner acid to purify it. I want crystal clear acid like this. Of all the common preparatory experiments an amateur chemist might do, I'd say distillation of sulfuric acid is probably one of the most dangerous. While there are much more dangerous experiments, they're mostly optional while sulfuric acid is required for a lot of things. For those of you who are new to chemistry and not familiar with sulfuric acid, it's an extremely common acid and used in a large number of chemical reactions and processes. It's one of the big three alongside hydrochloric acid and nitric acid. It has a very high boiling point of 337 Celsius, so it can actually be used to make other acids by distillation with the appropriate salt. It can also be used to sulfate organic compounds in advanced chemistry reactions. In pure form, it can dehydrate and burn organic substances, and under careful conditions, it can be used alongside nitric acid to make explosives. I don't do that chemistry very much on this channel, but it's out there. It's also quite dangerous in pure form, capable of burning flesh. It's infamous for being used in terrible acid attacks, and please do not Google those pictures because they are horrific. However, like any powerful tool, there are good purposes as well, and that's why we want to acquire some. I intend to use it for analytical chemistry. But because sulfuric acid is restrictive and hard to get in some countries, we have to purify it ourselves from lower grade sources. Drain cleaner is the most common, but if you can't get that, then battery acid is another. And you can even make sulfuric acid using various processes that we've already demonstrated on this channel, like the copper chloride process or the electrobromine process. Now, those of you who have been with me for a while have already seen me distill sulfuric acid using a homemade high temperature heating mantle. That video is still valid, and if you're already doing it that way, then by all means keep doing it. But I have since improved my technique, so I am going to do it again with a few improvements here. First is the heat source. In my previous video, we used a high temperature heating mantle that we built ourselves out of heating tape and a thermos. It worked well, but I have since upgraded to a ceramic hotplate stirrer. I can't use the standard aluminum hotplate stirrer because those are limited to about 300 Celsius, or else the aluminum starts to soften. But ceramic hot plates can go much higher, and this one can reach 540 Celsius, well past the boiling point of sulfuric acid at 337 degrees Celsius. Another problem with the mantle is that there is no stirring, and so bumping and splattering was a problem even with boiling chips. But stirring practically eliminates bumping. This ceramic hot plate stirrer does both. At this point, I want to thank the viewer that donated this particular hot plate stirrer those years ago. I really appreciate it. This is such an awesome unit that I actually use it very rarely because I'm afraid of breaking it. But when I do use it, it absolutely demolishes my other hot plate stirrers. Anyway, this is what we'll be using for heating. For the condenser, we'll be using this compact single unit distillation head and condenser column. The combined unit is simpler to use and mount than the usual two-piece combination of distillation head and column. The shorter condenser column isn't a problem for such a high boiling distillate as sulfuric acid. Technically, this is a short path distillation column, but we're not really using it in that mode and will be condensing at full boiling temperature. So it's a compact condenser in this context. There is no need for a fractional distillation column since the temperature difference between the water and the sulfuric acid azeotrope is over 200 Celsius, and the vapor pressures are wildly different. Previously, I used an ultra-high temperature grease for the joints as normal vacuum grease is destroyed by boiling sulfuric acid. But most amateurs have a hard time finding ultra-high temperature grease and the cost is not justified. I since found a much better alternative, and that's PTFE pipe threading tape. This tape is immune to boiling sulfuric acid and seals the joints almost as good as grease. It's also very cheap and easy to acquire for the amateur from their local hardware or plumbing store. So I no longer recommend using high temperature grease, but instead using PTFE pipe threading tape. And there we go. We now assemble it into our apparatus. I'm going to distill about 800 milliliters of drain cleaner grade sulfuric acid. I've assembled everything in this plastic polypropylene bin for safety. In the event of a catastrophic failure and something breaks, the boiling sulfuric acid should be contained by the bin, or at least slowed down. Previously, I relied on the heating mantle itself to safely contain the acid, but the ceramic hot plate can't do that. So that's why I'm using this bin. I'll further discuss the safety issues later on. Anyway, up here we have the cooling water hoses attached to the condenser, and I'm circulating room temperature water. Let me turn on the stirring. When boiling this much sulfuric acid, stirring is very helpful to prevent bumping or popping, which is caused by the bottom becoming superheated compared to the rest of the liquid, and then the bubbles violently expanding as they float up. Sulfuric acid is quite prone to it. The stirring keeps the bulk liquid at uniform temperature. Anyway, I'm also turning on the heating and I'm setting it to 200 Celsius to start, since I don't want to thermally shock the glassware. But every half hour, I raise the temperature another 100 Celsius until I reach about 500 Celsius. I'm also going to put a foil shroud around the flask to keep the heat in. And now we wait. At first, the sulfuric acid expands and darkens as the impurities char and decompose. Drain cleaner grade acid tends to be the waste product of industrial processes, which is why it has these impurities. Depending on the source, it can still be very good acid, so for reactions like making nitric acid, it's easier to just use the drain cleaner acid directly and distilling it is unnecessary. But for sensitive work like analytical chemistry or electroplating, pure acid is desired. I'm going to put some more insulating foil on the distillation column to help the acid distill over. This also helps to prevent water from recondensing and falling back into the acid where it can violently boil and inject the acid. And there we go. We're first distilling water. My drain cleaner acid doesn't have very much, so we don't have to wait long. But if you're distilling battery acid, which only has about 30% acid, then there'll be a lot of water before we can get to the sulfuric acid. Other methods for making sulfuric acid, like the electrobromine process, or the copper chloride process, or the lead chamber process, will also have considerable amounts of water that need to be distilled off first. On a different note, you can see my acid is getting lighter and lighter as the impurities have mostly decomposed. This tends to happen as the impurities that were charring and darkening earlier are now essentially burning away as the temperature rises. This is actually the basis for an analytical chemistry technique called sulfuric acid digestion, but we'll cover that in an upcoming video. As we distill off more and more water, we'll want to know when the sulfuric acid begins distilling over. It's hard to tell just by looking at it, but my preferred way is to simply get a tissue and capture a few drops of distillate as it comes off. If it's just water, it'll do nothing other than soak the tissue. Even diluted sulfuric acid won't have much effect. So we can continue distilling and testing every so often. If you have a thermometer in the distillation head, then when the distillate temperature rises above 300 Celsius is when we're distilling the sulfuric acid. If you're using the tissue method like I am, then we change the receiver when the tissue starts decomposing and charring. Only highly concentrated acid does this sort of damage. An interesting quirk about sulfuric acid is that 98% is the maximum concentration you can get by boiling. It's not because it's an azeotrope, even though we call it that. What's actually happening is that above 98% concentration, the sulfuric acid actually decomposes into water and sulfur trioxide. So even if you started with 100% pure sulfuric acid, if you distilled it, you would get 98% as some of it decomposes and leaves water behind while the sulfur trioxide escapes. So 98% sulfuric acid is not an azeotrope of sulfuric acid and water. What it actually is an azeotrope of sulfur trioxide and water. And thus, sulfuric acid can even be considered as a solution of sulfur trioxide. I just thought that was an interesting quirk about sulfuric acid. Looks like I'm distilling sulfuric acid now. Let me change out the receiver. Now we want the highest concentration of sulfuric acid we can get, which is the 98% azeotrope. We're not quite certain if we're there yet, but a way to tell is to simply use a small receiver and carefully observe it while it's collecting. It helps to put a high contrast background. Anyway, if there are distortions in the liquid as it drips, then that means the drops are of changing density and still rising. It looks like I have no distortions, and that means I'm distilling constant density sulfuric acid, which can only be the maximum 98% concentration sulfuric acid we're aiming for. Here's a clip of the distortions from my previous video on distilling sulfuric acid. As you can see, at this time the sulfuric acid was still boiling off the water, and so the acid distilling over wasn't at the maximum concentration yet. If you see something like this, then keep boiling and changing out the receiver every so often until it becomes a constant density. Since we've reached that density, we can now install our larger receiver and collect our purified 98% concentrated sulfuric acid. If you're using an already pure source of sulfuric acid like battery acid, or some form of diluted acid like that made by the sulfur dioxide and hydrogen peroxide method, then after water removal the acid is already pure and you don't have to distill it further. You can stop here and just use the acid in the boiling flask. But if you're using an impure acid like I am that has residues, we'll need to keep distilling to leave those behind. And there it goes. As we wait, we got time to talk about some background information and extra notes about the process. Something that I should address is my use of cooling water for the condenser. Some amateurs have reported that the glass can crack or even shatter from the thermal stress, and instead recommend pumping air through the condenser to provide milder cooling action. I've almost never had a glassware failure, so I continue to use cooling water. But if you're uncertain about the quality of your glassware, then forced air cooling should be considered. Alternatively, just use a very long condenser, as sulfuric acid condenses very well with just passive cooling. But whatever you do, always plan as part of your safety procedures how you'll contain and escape from a catastrophic failure in case something does break. Which brings me to my next point, the polypropylene plastic bin used to contain it. Some amateurs have expressed doubts whether a flimsy plastic bin can contain boiling hot sulfuric acid. They're absolutely right. Boiling hot sulfuric acid does destroy plastic pretty quickly. But the point of the bin isn't really to contain the boiling acid, but instead to buy you time to get away if the glass fails. If something bad should happen and sulfuric acid begins spilling, don't stand around to salvage it. Step back and cut power, and then wait for the acid to settle down and cool before approaching. The acid may still melt through the bin, but it should take a few seconds, giving you time to react and escape. If you can get a steel tray, that would be even better, as long as it has deep sides to contain the acid. But for the most part, a total glassware failure that unleashes the acid all at once is pretty rare. Usually there will be a crack and the acid leaks out. The plastic bin can contain a small leak of hot acid for several minutes, giving you ample time to deal with it. If you want to extend the containment time, possibly indefinitely, you can fill the container with sand or cat litter, put a few ceramic tiles on top, and then build the apparatus on the tiles. The sand or cat litter will absorb any spilling acid, and the mass will absorb the heat, protecting the bin and possibly allowing it to completely contain the acid spill. Looking back, I probably should have done the cat litter method, but maybe I'll do that in the future. Alternatively, if you want to completely prevent boiling sulfuric acid spilling in your lab, do the procedure outside your lab. A great many amateurs simply do this distillation outside on top of the ground where they don't mind ruining with boiling acid. When the weather gets better, I'll likely do the same. So what do you do if you do have boiling sulfuric acid pooling around your lab bench? Best thing you should do is to keep your distance. Hot sulfuric acid may set things on fire or explode when it reacts with something, splattering the acid on you. So as said before, don't approach it while it's hot. Also, do not neutralize it while it's hot. Pouring water or a base on hot acid can cause it to explode and splatter. And there have been some extremely horrific accidents where individuals have tried to do this. Wait until the acid is cold. If the acid has started a fire, extinguish the fire with a dry chemical fire extinguisher. I'm actually standing beside one while I'm doing this experiment. So what do you do when it's finally cold and ready to be cleaned up? Water and baking soda are usually used to neutralize and dilute it. But first look around to make sure the acid hasn't eaten through any electrical wiring. While PVC rubber insulation that most wiring has is resistant to cold sulfuric acid, it is not resistant to hot sulfuric acid. so be aware of that and cut power in the event of a major spill. In terms of safety gear, as usual, you should have face shields and thick fire retardant lab coats. Nothing too special compared to other experiments. The idea is to have as much material between you and the acid so the acid eats that first before it eats you. There isn't much in the way of clothing that is immune to boiling sulfuric acid, so approach from the idea that you're sacrificing the clothing to it. Another safety point I want to make is the sulfuric acid vapor. The vapor is extremely corrosive and you don't want it burning your lungs from the inside out. So perform this distillation outside in a fume hood. In theory, the vapor should be completely contained by the apparatus, but in the event of a failure, or even something as mundane as a bump, that vapor will go into the air. Additionally, as explained earlier, there can be a small amount of sulfur trioxide from the sulfuric acid decomposing. It's not much, but it absolutely should not be inhaled. At this point, a lot of you might be terrified of boiling sulfuric acid now, and you should be. As said before, distilling sulfuric acid is about the most dangerous procedure an amateur chemist is reasonably foreseen to do. Even most professionals consider it on the upper end of dangerous procedures. But as long as you respect those dangers and have proper safety procedures, it can be safely handled, contained, and controlled, even in the event of a catastrophic failure. So let's move on from the doom and gloom safety talk and discuss some of the other aspects of the experiments. You might be wondering how the stir bar survives such insanely corrosive conditions. The stir bar is a PTFE or Teflon-coated magnetic stir bar. PTFE is one of the few substances that is chemically immune to boiling sulfuric acid. However, at these temperatures, it can soften. It's still a plastic. Other amateurs have indeed reported their stir bars coming apart after prolonged boiling. Personally, my stir bars have proven completely immune, but your results may vary. Some lower grade stir bars will even lose their magnetism at these temperatures. So some amateurs make their own glass encapsulated stir bars from bar magnets and thick glass tubes for their sulfuric acid distillation. I was asked why I'm using aluminum foil if I can't use an aluminum hotplate. Aluminum softens at these temperatures and you want the hotplate to remain rigid. But it doesn't matter if aluminum foil softens because it's foil, just as long as it doesn't melt. So we can drape this in foil without worry. Aluminum doesn't melt until about 660 Celsius and we're at maximum 540. Now earlier I said I loved using PTFE tape to seal the joints, but I have been asked if sulfuric acid itself can be used to grease them. I know some amateurs have and report success. But the few times I've tried, the joints still seized up and were inseparable. So I cannot personally recommend using sulfuric acid to lubricate ground glass joints. And considering how cheap and easy to obtain PTFE tape is, I don't think I'll ever consider anything else for high temperature, highly corrosive experiments. And there we are, most of the sulfuric acid has been distilled over. The drain cleaner acid is relatively pure and has only a minor amount of salts that remain behind, although I'm sure any existing organic impurities were completely destroyed. Now we just store the acid in glass bottles, although some chemists prefer polypropylene bottles because there is less danger of them breaking if they are dropped. I guess I'm old school preferring my sulfuric acid in glass. Let me clean the surface because then we can label them. And there is our high-grade 98% concentrated sulfuric acid distilled from drain cleaner. To test the acid, we pour some of it on tissue and we can see it decompose in char. And that is the purification of sulfuric acid by distillation. I like this improved method because it avoids hard-to-find high-temperature grease and substitutes it with comparatively easy-to-find PTFE pipe threading tape. The tape also makes it very easy to take the joints apart when you're done. This improved method using the ceramic hot plate stir also greatly reduces dangerous bumping that boiling sulfuric acid is notorious for. The big drawback of this improved method is that you need to get a high temperature ceramic hot plate stir, which can be very expensive. But because of how useful they are for other experiments, I feel the cost is justified in the context of a larger laboratory. Anyway, I'm going to use this purified acid in upcoming videos on electroplating and analytical chemistry. So please subscribe, like, and comment. And if possible, please support me on Patreon so you can get more videos like this.